When information is transferred from one computer to another, how do we ensure it's transferred correctly? Information on computers is stored in binary, a sequence of bits that are either 0 or 1, that when taken together make up the data we care about. When data is transferred from one place to another, those zeros and ones are copied. The vast majority of the time, the copying is accurate. But every once in a while, an error occurs in transmission. A bit is flipped, and a 0 becomes a 1, or a 1 becomes a 0. If we're in a context where accuracy matters, though, we might need the ability to detect and correct these errors. And for now, we'll focus just on correcting errors where a single bit might be flipped. Since errors happen so infrequently, the ability to fix a single bit is often good enough. Say we're transmitting 4 bits of information. How could we encode the data such that we would know if a single bit had been flipped? To do so, we need extra information in the data we transmit, so we can use that information to detect errors. One strategy is to add a parity bit, shown in blue, to the data. The parity bit's job is to count the number of ones in the data. If there are an odd number of ones in the data, the parity bit should be set to 1. If there's an even number of ones in the data, the parity bit should be set to 0. When we receive a message, we can check the parity bit. If the parity bit is correct, we assume the data was transmitted accurately. But if a bit was flipped, then the parity bit will be wrong. If there's an even number of ones in the data we receive, for example, the parity bit should be a 0, so if it's a 1, we know there's been an error. This gives us a way to detect if there's an error, but it doesn't give us a way to correct that error. All we can say is that one of the bits is wrong, but we don't know which. It could be any of the 4 data bits, or it could even be the parity bit. To determine which bit has the error, we need more information. So instead of 1 parity bit, we'll use 3. Why 3? Well, based on the values of the parity bits, we need a way either to conclude there is no error, or to determine which bit is in error. And with 3 parity bits, we can represent 8 possible values. And that works out perfectly, because we need 1 value to represent no error, 4 values to represent errors in any of the 4 data bits, and 3 more values to represent errors in any of the 3 parity bits. So 3 parity bits gives us exactly enough information to potentially correct any single bit error. We previously used the parity bit to indicate if there were an odd number of ones in the data. But if all 3 parity bits were calculated this way, all parity bits would have the same value, which isn't very helpful. Instead, we want to use each of our parity bits and have it be calculated using a different combination of data bits, such that any given data bit is used in the calculation of a unique set of parity bits. That way, depending on which parity bits indicate an error, we can determine which bit is the cause. With 4 data bits and 3 parity bits, we have 7 bits to transmit, 1 through 7. Each number from 1 to 7 can be represented in binary using 3 bits. 1 is 001, 2 is 010, 3 is 011, and so on. Notice that each number has a unique representation. This, then, is our guide for which data bits should be included in the calculation of each parity bit. One parity bit will be calculated based only on the bits that have a 1 in this first row. Another parity bit will look at the bits that have a 1 in this second row. And another parity bit will consider bits that have a 1 in this third row. Now, here's the next question. Of these 7 bits, which 3 of them should be the parity bits? Well, we want parity bits calculated based on data bits alone. In other words, we never want one parity bit calculated based on another parity bit. So to make that happen, we can make the 3 parity bits the bits that are only involved in a single row. That way, they don't influence each other. And that's all the information we need to encode our data. we first fill in all the data bits. And now, the first parity bit is set based on whether there's an odd number of ones in these bits, which have a 1 in this row. There's an even number of ones, so we set the parity bit to 0. The second parity bit is set based on whether there are an odd number of ones in these bits, which have a 1 in this row. There's an odd number of ones, so this parity bit is set to 1. And for the third parity bit, we look at the bits that have a 1 on this row. There's an even number of ones, so the parity bit is set to 0. So what happens if we receive the message and the bit has been flipped? We first need to check which parity bits indicate an error. The first parity bit is wrong. Among the data bits it includes, there are an odd number of ones, but the parity bit is 0. The second parity bit is fine. There are an odd number of ones, and the parity bit is 1. The third parity bit is wrong. There's also an odd number of ones, but the parity bit is 0. So the first and the third parity bits were wrong. Now, which of the bits was included in both the first and third parity bits? Well, that's bit 5, whose binary representation is 101. Given that, we can conclude that the fifth bit is the error, and by flipping it, we have now corrected our data. And that's the technique. By adding 3 parity bits, we can detect and correct any 1-bit error in 4 data bits. Now, that might not seem particularly memory efficient, but this type of code, called a Hamming code, gets more efficient as the number of bits increases. With 247 data bits, for example, we need just 8 parity bits to be able to correct all possible 1-bit errors. So with just a little bit of extra information, we can build computer memory that's tolerant of possible errors. When an error occurs, our memory will be able to detect it, figure out which bit caused the problem, and then make the necessary correction.